In third grade, I was learning how to write cursive, but despite all the training, my signature still has this hideousness to it. Some of the other kids didn't seem to need cursive. They didn't need braces or speech therapy either. They knew how to draw the cool S. Here's a bit of math. What is this S anyways? It's an elegant shape made out of 14 straight line segments, but I don't even know how to make one.
You'd think my school had cool S classes, with how many cool S's my classmates were drawing in their notebooks. All I had in my notebooks were notes, and I never took notes on how to draw the cool S. I'm sure we can figure it out, though.
To start the cool S, we draw three congruent parallel line segments, then do it again, directly underneath the first three, then connect these two, and these two, then draw this piece here, and a similar little thing over here. Little triangle on bottom, bop, a little triangle on top, pow.
Wow, that's the cool S. It looks even cooler than I remembered. If I knew how to draw this in school, I'll bet I could have flunked way more of my classes, just like all the other cool guys who drew the cool S. It wasn't just called the cool S, though. Sometimes it was called the super S, or the graffiti S, or the pointy S. Whatever you call it, I'm just glad it looks as cool as it does without color. I'd hate to color the cool S because I hate coloring.
Imagine, though, if we did want to color the S. How long would that take? I guess that depends on the area of the S. Whatever its area is, that's the amount we'd have to color. Well, let's see. I know how to find the area of a triangle.
Nope.
I know how to find the area of a rectangle.
Nope.
Well, I can find the area of parallelograms.
Nope. Darn it! What is this blasted shape? I guess with a tricky shape like this, we really have to analyze it. What is the S made up of? If we can break it down into smaller shapes that we do know how to work with, we can find the areas of those shapes and use that information to find the area of the S. Then we can be extra grateful that we don't have to color it.
If we're going to break out our geometry on this S, we need to be very specific about how it is constructed. There are a few variants on ways to make the S, but let's do it like this. Pick a length, say X. We draw three parallel vertical line segments, all of length X. But how far apart should they be? We want our S to be beautiful, and symmetry's beautiful, so let's make the segments a distance of X apart, and make sure they line up perfectly so that the angles between them are 90 degrees. Then, let's make the other three line segments similarly. X units long, X units apart, and X units below the original three segments. For convenience, let's go ahead and label the endpoints of our segments A through L. Then, by placing these six segments, we have forced the segment from B to I to look like this, and the segment from D to K to look like this. Similarly, we have this segment from G to D, except it stops once it meets the segment BI, at a point we'll call P. And we have this segment from F to I, but it stops when it meets the segment DK, at a point we'll call Q.
All that remains are the pointy parts on the top and bottom. How should we construct these? You might think, in keeping with symmetry, we should make them X units long. Let's do it.
Like that, and like that. Oh.
What the f**k is this?
Turns out there's this annoying thing called the triangle inequality. If we draw these segments to meet the way we want them to, at a point we'll call M, then what we'll have here is a triangle with base length 2x. The triangle inequality states that the sum of any two sides of a proper triangle must be greater than the third side. So since this side has length 2x, our other two sides both have to be greater than x, assuming we want them to be congruent, which we do because that looks nice.
So, what should we do? We could make the segments each 2x or some other number greater than x. How about x.1? Or, I know, we can't do x. Maybe 2x seems kind of boring. How about we do square root of 2 times x?
Note that the intersection point M is chosen so that CM is perpendicular to AE. Picking square root of 2 times x for the length of AM and EM might seem kind of weird, but there's a good reason for it. Instead of thinking about picking a length for AM and EM, let's think about CM. The length of CM is the distance between C and where these two segments meet. So let's pick that distance instead. How far from C should AM and EM meet? Well, for this distance, we can pick x. So say CM has length x. This will actually force AM and EM both to have a length of square root of 2 times x. Remember, we chose M so that CM is perpendicular to AE. Thus, these are two congruent right triangles with leg lengths of x. By the Pythagorean theorem, the sum of the squares of the legs of a right triangle equals the square of the hypotenuse. In our case, the leg lengths are both x. So x squared plus x squared equals the hypotenuse squared, which means the hypotenuse is the square root of 2x squared. And we can take the perfect square out of the root to get that AM, the hypotenuse, as well as our other congruent hypotenuse, EM, are both the square root of 2 times x, just like we wanted. Then, of course, we can do the same thing at the bottom of our S to finish things off. Say the segments from H and L meet at a point N that's x units away from J. Again, choose this point so that HL and JN meet at a right angle.
Finally, a proper S. I swear, my classmates must have been geometers of Euclid's caliber the way they banged these things out. Geez, we haven't even started finding the area yet. Turns out I hate drawing and coloring.
Now that our cool S has been drawn, how do we find the area? To take the most basic approach, we can break S into its most obvious components. We know the top and bottom consists of these congruent triangles. Then we have this quadrilateral, AEFB. Even better, because we constructed these segments specifically to have an angle of 90 degrees between them, this is a rectangle.
I love rectangles!
What are the dimensions of this rectangle? AB and EF are both x, and AE and BF are both 2x. Similarly, GKLH is a rectangle. We know how to find the areas of triangles and rectangles, so we're in the clear so far. All that's left to account for is the weird stuff going on in the middle. BDKI is another parallelogram, but this time it isn't a rectangle. We know it's a parallelogram since its opposite sides are congruent. We already know BD and IK have length x, and BI and DK are both hypotenuses of right triangles with leg lengths of x, so they're congruent too. If we call BD and IK the bases of this parallelogram, then the distance between BD and IK is the height of the parallelogram, and we already chose that distance to be x.
Our analysis is almost done. All that's left is to take a look at these little triangles, then we can calculate the areas of all the pieces and find the area of the cool S.
What do we know about these little triangles? Whatever arguments we make for one of them could analogously be applied to the other, so let's just focus on triangle GPI. Perhaps the easiest shape we could work with would be a square. And if we draw BD, DI, and GB, it looks like BDIG just might be a square.
I love squares!
We're already close to proving BDIG is a square because BD, DI, IG, and GB are all x units long, since we constructed them that way. This is enough to establish that BDIG is a parallelogram, which means its opposite angles are congruent. So, to show that all the angles are 90 degrees and prove it's a square, we just need to show that angles GBD and IGB are 90 degrees. This is actually cake too.
It's what?
We already established that AEFB and GKLH are rectangles, meaning ABF and GHL are right angles. But since angles GBD and IGB are supplementary to those right angles, they must be right angles themselves. And then, since opposite angles of a parallelogram are congruent, this tells us the other two angles are right as well, and thus BDIG is a square.
Yeah, square!
Remember, we constructed GP as a piece of the segment GD. So GP lies on the diagonal GD of our square. The diagonals of a square cut it into four congruent right triangles, and with that information, knowing that GPI is one of those triangles, since its legs are each half of a diagonal, we just need to divide the area of the square by four to find the area of triangle GPI.
We're done all the preliminary work. At long last, we can find the area of the cool S when constructed with segment length X. I'll bet it's so much area I'd get dehydrated if I so much as attempted to color it in.
We determined these two triangles will have a fourth the area of the squares that contain them. Each square has area x squared, so each triangle has area 1/4 x squared, and so together they have an area of 1/2 x squared. The middle parallelogram has an area of its base, x, times its height, also x, so an area of x squared. The rectangles have an area of length times width, so 2x times x, so 2x squared for each one, or 4x squared when combined. Finally, the top and bottom triangles have an area of 1/2 base times height. The bases are each 2x, and the heights are both x. So each triangle has an area of 1/2 times 2x times x, or x squared, or 2x squared when combined. So in total, if we construct a cool S using segment lengths of x, the area is 2x squared plus 4x squared plus x squared plus 1/2 x squared, which is 7.5 x squared.
Now, you may be thinking, that was annoying. Could we not have done that any faster? And yes, we could have, especially now that we know so much about the shape of the cool S. I even got its social security number and home address. So soon, I'll be the cool S.
But before any cool S identity theft, how else could we have calculated the area of the S? Well, consider this. The S is inscribed in a rectangle of length 5x and width 2x. So the rectangle has area 10x squared. Of course, that's a little too big. To correct the area, we need to subtract the area of these four congruent triangles and these other two congruent triangles. The triangles on the corners are right isosceles, with base and height x, so each one has area 1/2 x squared, so their combined area is 2x squared, leaving 8x squared behind. These smaller triangles on the sides are each 1/4 of the area of the square that contains them. Just like before, that means each triangle has an area of 1/4 x squared. So together, their area is 1/2 x squared. Cutting those out leaves the area of the cool S, 7.5 x squared, just like before.
It looks like we were right. but it's very easy to make math mistakes, so checking our answer by solving a problem again, or better yet, solving it in a different way, is always good practice. That's why anytime I get out of a speeding ticket, I speed some more to test out some alternative solutions.
For maximum confidence, here's one more way we could calculate the area of the S. This one is my favorite. Remember how we drew GP so that it would meet D if it were continued, and we drew FQ so it would meet I if continued. Continuing these segments with dotted lines makes another solution appear almost immediately. The area of the S is the area of these two congruent hexagons, minus the area of the square where they overlap. We have to subtract the square where they overlap, because by adding the area of the hexagons, we count that area twice, when we should only count it once. The area of the top hexagon can easily be calculated as the area of the triangle on top, which is x squared, plus the area of the triangle on bottom, which is congruent to the one on top, and so also has area x squared, plus the rectangle in the middle, which has area 2x squared. So the top hexagon has area 4x squared. The hexagon on the bottom is the same, so we have 8x squared minus the area of the square in the middle. The square in the middle is just composed of two triangles that we already established have an area of 1/4 x squared. So the square's area is 1/2 x squared. Subtracting that area to correct the double counting gives the final area of the S once again as 7.5 x squared.
So if you drew the cool S using segment lengths of 3 inches, its area would be 7.5 times 3 inches squared, which is 7.5 times 9 square inches, which is 67.5 square inches. And in general, now you know all those cool S's you drew that had equally spaced congruent and parallel line segments and a triangle on top with a third vertex also equally spaced from the middle segment and a similarly drawn triangle on bottom all had an area of 7.5 times the square of the uniform length of the segments you used to construct the S. Of course, nobody actually crafted their S's with such precision, so we actually didn't learn anything. Well, that's not quite true. I finally perfected my signature!